The following teaching is possible thanks to the friends and partners of Spirit and Truth Fellowship International.
One of the great truths of the Bible is that there's one God. And God said this so plainly and beautifully. It's the Shema of Israel, if you will, the rallying cry of the Jews for you know, tens and tens and hundreds of generations. Deuteronomy 6:4, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." And that's translated out of the NIV. But the simple, plain truth of Scripture is that there's one God. Now, in the discussions between Trinitarians and Biblical Unitarians, we Biblical Unitarians say what we're looking for is plain, simple statements like Deuteronomy 6:4, that the Lord is one, that there's one God. The way the Trinitarians interpret this is they'll say, well, you know, there is one God, but he's composed of three people. There's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and together the three of them make one God. And our biblical Unitarian position is that's not the teaching of Scripture. Are there places where three things are mentioned? Sure. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Christ is teaching. He says, "Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." Are there three? Absolutely. There's the Father, and there's the Son, and the Holy Spirit, should be a small h, small s, is the power of God in operation. So, sure, Christ says, baptize in the authority of the Father and the Son, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, but there's no plain verse of Scripture that says the three are one. The plain verses of Scripture, and this, I think, is such an important point, but it's because as Christians, as believers, as followers of the Lord, what we're trying to do is figure out who is God and who is Jesus. And the Bible is very clear. God is one God. Now, I know that there are people who would say, but, you know, the Hebrew word one, echad, well, that refers to a compound unity. And that argument has been made or tried, people have tried to make that argument, and frankly, it doesn't hold water. The word echad simply means one. And I'd like to read some sources about that. I'm going to start with The Doctrine of the Trinity by Anthony Buzzard. And here's what Anthony Buzzard has to say in his book, The Doctrine of the Trinity. He says, "The claim that one really means compound oneness is an example of argument by assertion without logical proof." And then he quotes the theologian, he says, "holds that echad does not mean an absolute one, but a compound one. The argument involves an easily detectable linguistic fallacy. Echad appears some 960 times in the Hebrew Bible." That's a lot of times. "And in no case does the word itself carry a hint of plurality. It means strictly one and not two or more. Echad is a numerical adjective and naturally enough is sometimes found modifying a collective noun, like one family, one herd, one bunch. But we should observe carefully that the sense of plurality resides in the compound noun, not in the word one." In other words, what Buzzard is saying is, yeah, there's times it'll say one herd, but the compoundness is in the herd, not in the word one. Now, again, with any word occurring over 900 times in the Old Testament, it's pretty easy to get out a concordance and check and see if the word one is compound or not. I mean, when you just simply look it up in a lexicon, it's one when you have the number, one. It's the first in a series. It's one in the sense of the same. It's one in the sense of each or a certain one. And none of those uses are compound. So then we just say, well, let's go into the Bible itself and see how it's used. Genesis chapter 1, verse 5. Remember the first day? That's echad. There wasn't a compound unity. It was just day one. Simple. Genesis 11 with the Tower of Babel, the whole earth spoke one language. Hagar, she took her child and cast him under one of the bushes in Genesis 21. In Pharaoh's dream, there were 7 ears of grain on one stalk. The plague on Egypt's livestock, if you remember that back with Moses and the plagues, not one cow died in Israel. That was in Exodus chapter 9. And then Exodus 12, 49 says, Israel shall have one law for its citizens and the foreigners. I mean, obviously, I can't go into over 900 usages and march through the whole Bible, but you could if you wanted to. And the point is that what we're going to find if we actually do that is one means one. It just does. Now, let's think about the Jews and their one God. Because if there was one thing in biblical times that the Jews were known for, it was their ferocity toward the maintenance of the belief in one God. When the pagans would try to come in with their idols and with more than one God, the Jews just went berserk. There were riots, there were wars, and the Jews ferociously defended the fact that there was one God. Why? Because their rallying cry right in the heart of Torah, Deuteronomy 6:4, says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And so they believed that, and they clung to that. You know, and it's worth reading what some of the people have said. This is Elliot, William Elliot, and here's what he writes. He says, I do not know of any other arguments now used to prove that a plurality of persons is hinted at in the Old Testament. One thing, very important, is certain, and I would agree. This is a very important thing. We need to pay attention that if any such hint was conveyed, the Jews never understood them. Right, the Jews certainly weren't believing in a Trinity or even something that was hinted at is a plurality in their Godhead. They just had one God. The presumption, says Eliot, is that they knew their own language, and it's certain they understood that the unity of God was taught by their scriptures in the most absolute and unqualified manner. Such was their interpretation of Moses and the prophets at the time when Christ came. In all Palestine, there probably could not have been found a single man or woman who supposed that there was a distinction of the persons, such as is now taught, in the unity of God. If therefore such a doctrine is contained in the New Testament, it must have been completely new revelation to the Jews. And not only new, but also strange. At first sight, it must have appeared to them then as it does now, subversive of their ancient doctrine. It would have been necessary, therefore, for the Savior and his apostles to state it very plainly and to prove its consistency with the law of Moses. And that, I think, is a great point, that if the Jews didn't believe the Trinity, and if Jesus wanted them to, he would have had to have taught it very plainly, and he didn't. If we find no such statement, we may conclude that there was no such doctrine, and that's exactly what we biblical Unitarians have concluded, that God is one, period, one God, and he sent his Son. You know, in 1824, J.S. Hindman wrote a book called Lectures on Principles of Unitarianism. Here's what he wrote in 1824. The Jews, who were made depositories of God's word, and to whom he would certainly address himself in a language they could understand, could have no idea that by the appellation God, in other words, by the name God, was meant three distinct persons subsisting in unity of essence, or that singular pronouns were used to denote a plurality of persons, meaning the Jews just didn't know anything about any kind of Trinity. And why? Because it wasn't revealed in their scripture, and certainly not in the word one, which the Jews just took literally. There's one God. He says, we also find that Jesus Christ himself speaks of Jehovah as one being. And I think it's important when we realize that when Jesus Christ talked about God, which he did all the time, that none of the Jews listening to him would assume that he was speaking of himself. they would have assumed that he was talking about God, which he was. And by the way, does the New Testament confirm the truth that there's one God? Oh, it does, over and over. Let's think about James chapter 2, verse 19. James is writing, "You believe that there's one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder." Sure, because they're going to be judged by the one God. And again, the Greek word one is hais, and it like echad, just means one. Or 1 Timothy 2:5, again, a very clear verse. There's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. So what's the testimony of Scripture about our God? The testimony of Scripture is that God is one. There's one God, and then he loved the world so much, he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to save us from our sin and make available everlasting life. God bless you.